Boo! Welcome to another episode of Wasn't That Something? As death and decay surround us all, and boreal autumn's grip tightens on our homes, I take delight in a subject so beautiful, yet so maddening, as to split the hearts of humans in half. Of course, a half being a most uncanny, proper fraction. I am invoking the darkest of the dark STEM arts, one you can always count on for a good scare. Mathematics! According to Spookypedia, mathematics includes the study of such topics as quantity, or accursed number theory, structure, or infernal algebra, space, or the devil's geometry, and change, or demonic mathematical analysis. However, as well studied as math is, it has no generally accepted definition.
Spooky.
Just as humans grow to love ghost stories and scary movies, so shall we immerse ourselves in math. So shall we grow transfixed by its compelling inner beauty, or if not, we shall be doomed to a lifetime of horror, difficulty tipping appropriately, and engineering mishaps. If I were to delve into the entirety of this phantasmic field of functions and figuring out, this video would never end, and while that thought pleases me infinitely, I will spare the remainder of your lives and limit this video to a few of the most bone-chilling examples
of monster math.
First, let's explore group theory. This is an abstract field of math usually only studied by ghoulish academics, fetid physicists, and the like. One way to understand groups is to consider them as a collection of symmetries of some kind of mathematical object and some operation, often thought of as some kind of terrible multiplication, that composes these symmetries together. Most groups of finite size can be lumped into one of 18 reasonable families. There are, however, 26 ghastly groups who don't fit into any of these well-adjusted families. These undead 26 finite groups are called the sporadic groups, and the largest of these is called the monster group.
Hey!
This group describes the symmetries of an object in 196,883 dimensions. Each member, each spooky symmetry of this group is a matrix consisting of about 5 gigabytes of information. And how many of these massive elements are in the monster group? 808 sextillion, 17 quindecillion, 424 quattuordecillion, 794 tredecillion, 712 duodecillion, 875 undecillion, 886 decillion, 459 nonillion, 904 octillion, 961 septillion, 710 sextillion, 707 quintillion, 754 quadrillion, 368 trillion precisely. Note that this is a precise value and it's not rounded off to the nearest trillion or anything like that. Usually, when we think of numbers representing profound mathematical truths about the universe, we expect clean, sensible, round numbers. The universe doesn't care what we believe, however. Take it from Grant Sanderson of 3 Blue, 1 Brown.
To me, the monster and its absurd size is a nice reminder that fundamental objects are not necessarily simple. The universe doesn't really care if its final answers look clean. They are what they are by logical necessity, with no concern over how easily we'll be able to understand them.
Thanks to Grant for letting me use that clip from his in-depth video about the monster group. Nobody does the monster math like Grant. If you haven't seen his video already, check it out, if you dare. Just when you thought you were safe, trigonometry. Why a jump scare like that? Well, because cosine can. There are a few shapes as chilling as trigons, and if you study the right trigons, you unlock a cursed tomb of functions more delicious than a Dutch apple pie. If we choose to focus on a particular acute angle within our right trigon, let's call it zombie theta, then we can label the sides of our trigon thusly. First, the elephant in the dungeon,
hey.
The longest side of the triangle, is always called the hypotenuse, because the cult of Pythagoras likes it like that, and you don't want to get on their bad side. Seriously though, they straight up murdered the guy who proved that root 2 was irrational. It's a whole thing. Anyway, back to our doomed triangle. Let's call the side opposite of zombie theta the opposite side, and the side adjacent to zombie theta the adjacent side. Trigon maniacs call the ratio between the length of the opposite side and the hypotenuse the sine. You can take the sine of any angle you like. If you take the sine of a worthless angle, like 0, you get 0. If you take the sine of pi over 6, you get 1/2. If you take the sine of pi over 2, we get 1. What if we take the sine of the beast? By the way, to be clear, I'm using radians here. I want to make a scary video about math, but I'm not depraved enough to use degrees to measure angles. Anyway, the sine of 666 is a transcendental number, the most mysterious and ghoulish kind of number, with the value of around negative 0.018. Since 666 is often called the sine of the beast, we now have the sine of the sine of the beast as being a negative number. That is, a number whose sine is negative. The angle 666 in radians comes around to a nearly complete circle, similar to the outer shape of a do not enter sign, whose interior also resembles a minus sign, making that a sine of the 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 beast. If you autographed this, then you'd have signed the sine of 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 the beast. A signed sign of the sine 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 of the beast is available on Patreon. Click the link in the description for more. What about math that you can hold in your hand, like the skulls of your enemies? Try this. Find a deck of cards in your coffin or wherever. Now, shuffle them. Like, really do it well. If you have shuffled the deck thoroughly enough, then you are nearly certainly holding a deck of cards with an order that has never occurred in the history of the universe. This might seem impossible at first, but there's no hocus pocus here. Just cold, hard factorials. There are 52 ways to order a deck of cards. That's what I would say if I read that using regular non-spooky math punctuation. What I should have said is that there are 52 factorial ways to order a deck of cards. Factorials are actually fairly straightforward. 52 factorial is just 52 times 51 times 50 times 49, blah, 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 all the way down to 1. That is about 8 times 10 to the 67 ways that an ordinary deck of cards can be arranged. That's a huge number. Remember the size of the monster group? 52 factorial is 100 trillion times bigger than the size of the monster. What kind of evil math magic is this? So far, all the numbers we've dealt with have been real. Or have they? Yes, but there are numbers that are distinctly not real, and I'm going to tell you all about them. The so-called imaginary numbers are like regular numbers, but they live in the upside down. Really though, they are based on the number I, the square root of negative 1. In real numbers, there's no such thing as the square root of a negative number, but it turns out that if we unlock the door to the upside down and allow those numbers to exist, all sorts of fun and useful math and science becomes possible. If we combine the real number line with the imaginary number line, we travel to a new plane of existence, the complex plane. While I'd love to explore the complex plane a little more, it does get pretty, well, complex, so maybe I'll save that for a less diabolical video. Math. I do want to spend a little time on I though. Specifically, there are two things I'd like to do to I. What kind of grotesque monstrosity would we get if we took the imaginary number I and raised it to the ith power? Well, thanks to the spectral wizard of math, Leonard Euler, this is actually not too tough to work out. Using Euler's formula, we know that e to the ix equals cosine x plus I sine x. Recall our accursed adventures in trigonometry. Trigonometry! We can plug in any value we want for x. If we choose carefully and select x equals pi over 2, then we find that e to the I pi over 2 is equal to I. Therefore, if we want to find I to the I, we can just substitute e to the I pi over 2 for the first I, and then using our freaky knowledge of exponents, we can bring the second I down, leaving us with e to the I squared pi over 2. Since I is the root of negative 1, I squared is just negative 1, leading us to find that I to the I can be expressed as e to the negative pi over 2. What's truly haunting about that is that e to the negative pi over 2 is a real number, existing without any imaginary components at all. We took an imaginary number, raised it to an imaginary power, and where did we end up? Right back on the real number line. Imagine that. It's like if a Demogorgon was raised to the Demogorgon power and spit out Samwise Gamgee into the right side up. Now, let's monster mash some of a previous topic into our imaginary realm. What if we look at I factorial? Not only does this notation look super spooky, but it also, at least on its face, seems not to make sense. The factorial operation is defined only on non-negative integers, the least ghoulish of the numbers. There is, however, a fiendish function that will do our bidding, representing the factorials accurately, but extending them into the upside-down world of the complex plane. This function is known as the gamma function. If we choose to interpret I factorial in terms of this function, we find that I factorial is approximately 0.5 minus 0.15i, the last cobweb-ridden corner of the dank dungeon of math that I want to explore is using binary numbers, just like your device is doing right now. Binary is a system of numbers where each digit can only hold one of two values, 0 or 1. Interestingly, 1 and 0 are sometimes interpreted as true and false, and these truth values are used in Boolean algebra. Anyway, let's learn how to count in binary using fangs. Let each tooth represent a different power of 2. If a fang is present, consider that to be a 1 or a true value for that power of 2. Check it out. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now let's go bigger. 33, 45. And now the most evil number of all, 63. Well, I've hit my limit on evil mathematics, and it's starting to feel a bit derivative at this point. Despite how excruciating it may seem for some, there is a deep beauty in mathematics, and it is integral to uncountably many aspects of all our lives. Wasn't that something? Wasn't That Something was written, recorded, and edited by me, Ralph Crewe. Unhinged and Regular music by Kyle Simpson. Special thanks to Grant Sanderson of 3 Blue 1 Brown for letting me use his video about the Monster Group. If you enjoyed this video, please consider liking, subscribing, hitting the bell, sharing, and all of that evil stuff. If you really want to support me, please join my Patreon. Check the link in the description for more. Thanks for watching, and remember, explore the world responsibly.